up one morning and I was like, I miss people. I miss making music with them, for them. I miss these spaces that amplify our voices and our intentions, our creative intentions in a special way. I miss all this stuff and I don't know how to tell anybody. And so we talked about it and came up with this way to kind of give an inside out presentation of what it means to stand in front of people and make music, and what it means in terms of all the people behind the scenes that make that pinnacle moment even possible.
You know, I think about how many of us are home now, missing the opportunity to go into these beautiful venues. Many cultural venues where people have memberships, where they've made decisions about what places they want to be fed cultural and creative experiences in. Those are places that people choose. And so they have life, they connect to those folks. So it's so beautiful to hear an artist like an incredible Liz Wright talk about what it feels like to perform in those spaces and what those spaces give back to her. And that's something, you know, as an audience member, I've never really heard. So I'm excited to hear that story.
When you're walking out, you're thinking and you're probably scoping out the crowd and the venue and looking how it looks because you've seen it all day empty at the sound check. But once you start playing, you're usually not really thinking about anything, you know?
When I walk on stage, my first thing is to read the audience. But it's about pleasing my bandmates and pleasing Liz.
To me, it's about like establishing an environment for everyone to settle into. I mean, that's the feeling it has. You know, we're setting something up.
Okay, where's the crowd right now? I feel this energy. How can I connect with them? How can I bring them to my world? And how can I join them? So for me, it was more like opening the door, not only for me to connect with the crowd, but for when Ben comes in, for him to connect with me, and then when everybody else in the band comes in, and then just setting that bed for when Liz comes out, she feels that, and she's like, okay, this is where we're going.
The wind that shakes the barley, it will not shake me. The wind that shakes the barley, it will not shake me. The wind that shakes the barley, won't shake me. Like my mother told me, this I know when I see. The fire that takes to kindling will not take me the fire.
I'm always the first coming into the room, checking out, like, you know, taking like a sort of back line, making sure everything is there, checking the PA, the desk and everything. So I look around. Sometimes I don't know the places, sometimes I do. And I try to visualize, you know, the night. And then it's always very, very interesting because normally sound changes drastically when people are in, and it doesn't matter if it is a club or a theater, it changes. So I adjust immediately. And after a while, I check on the musicians. I check on Liz, if she's happy, if the musicians are happy. So everything I do is to please the band, to please Liz, and then also to please the audience. So I look around, look at the people. How do they look? You know, are they happy? Are they listening? Are they kind of frowning or something? So, you know, can I do something to make it more comfortable, to transport the music? Sometimes it's a challenge and sometimes I'm getting goosebumps, really. And Berlin was one of those goosebumps shows.
Whatever room I walk into, especially being a single note instrument, at least for the most part, at a time, that room, the natural acoustics of it are something that I'm putting on. You know, it's like a dress, you know, and it's like, to be able to take one of your favorite sonic designers with you and every room be made to fit the meaning of like what I have as a voice, you know, and what I have as an emotional person, a storyteller, is a really cool experience. So it is true. It's like this other layer of architecture that I never thought about it like that. It's really cool. I really am thankful for how you do such a unique job in Europe of upholding the tradition of jazz. And we really have you to thank for it. It's not like you're hearing lots of jazz right now. I know. I'm not singing any standards, but my point is, we really, really appreciate, you know, your support, and it's so nice to have this kind of beautiful global dialogue. It's nice to have some other messages running besides, I don't know, fake news and whatnot, you know. Things have changed since I've seen you last, but the best things have not.
Designer, I love architecture. I love buildings. I build things all the time. And I've been fortunate enough to move around with you guys. You know, that's been such a blessing for me to be able to go to all of these places, be in these halls, in these venues. And I posed the question to Liz, and I said, you know, what about the idea of connecting with people around, not just sharing with them how much you miss them, but also, what do you think about how people are feeling about these spaces? Because they're missing you, and they're missing, you know, all of you as performers, but they also are connected to the places that you all have performed in. It's almost like a love letter. You know, it's like letting people know that although you are not with them, you are still thinking of them.
When we're in a city like Berlin, for example, you always want to go walk around. And then that, to me, always changes potentially the energy of the show. There's something about being around whatever you're going to go see, whether it's old architecture, go walk around a river and just have a whole view of the city, or seeing people walk around and seeing locals and how life is, and at the show, obviously, as an extension. But I love walking around the city before a show. I think it's so motivating.
I miss them. I miss the people. When you're forced in a situation like we are to not be able to do what we do, which so much of it is traveling and interacting with people all around the world, to be able to do that is really in your body. It's just part of your being. I'm an introvert, I'm a reluctant performer, you know, but it's about playing music and connecting with people. It's a huge part of my life. So yeah, definitely miss the people there and most any other places that we travel, really.
Obviously, I really miss touring. And being around these, in my perspective, very different people, you know, very different human beings who have a different perspective on almost everything, every subject. Or like Chris was saying now, he's an introvert, you know, so I don't have much interaction with introverts. So when I'm on tour with him, I can sort of dive into a little bit of his world, you know, and so is everyone else. You know, you get a little bit of a glimpse into someone else's life.
I just miss the feeling of a song coming out of my body. I miss that. You know, there's a way that people listen to you in performance, like on stage. You're not listened to in that way at any other time or part of your life, really. And it can draw out of you more information than you know that you have to share. And it can let you deeper into yourself to be in front of people like that. They make a place of you. You try to sing these songs and, you know, my mind is scanning over fields, some of them pastures that my dad would pass on a long, you know, winding road on the way to church, this little storefront church. It was full of like people who were neighbors. And I was attempting to teach Sunday school, though I wasn't much older than the kids. And I remember all of that stuff when I'm singing, my eyes are closed. My mind just kind of rambles. And I go into a mode where I know the words and they're coming out and I can hear music. But people, the presence of people has this kind of gravity and it pulls out of me all of these stories and images and sets off like a kind of movie in my brain. And I don't know how to trigger that on my own, but it's become a part of my life. I've been doing it for all of my life, really, but professionally for, you know, 2 decades. So I woke up one morning and I could actually feel the way that the German people in particular, the way they listen has like a magnetism to it. It's very unique, and it really, it almost forces me to speak a different way. You know, it's really cool. It's every conversation, of course, that we ever have of any kind, every communion we have draws out of us something that is for the life in front of us. So I just felt that, and it felt like missing a person. It was weird, but beautiful.
Power going out is what I remember. I thought that was such an incredible moment, because that's when you see what kind of crowd it is. I mean, everybody got up and started singing.
You know, lit by some twilight emergency lights, and kept going for a couple of minutes, actually.
It was church.
That's right.
It was a black church experiment. Black church is kind of like, it's a spiritual realm where people are able to show emotion. The black people are very emotional people, and that's kind of where the spirit realm is created. You know, you just have to be in a black church to see, like, when stuff goes out, or when the piano's not in tune, or the organ, somebody, you know, steps on the cord or something, everything goes on. It just goes on. It keeps going on, and the spirit just keeps on moving.
So much. Really, thank you for having us this wonderful venue. You're so amazing. What a great last stop. Thank you all so much.